You can hear my dog, Tyke, barking his head off in the background, as if we were under attack. Well, it would appear that the facts speak for themselves. 10 counts of genocide being waged against the people of these islands and virtually everywhere else on the planet every minute of the day. Referendum results for Scottish independence have given rise to a plethora of not only credible witness testimony, albeit second-hand knowledge at this present juncture, but the witness testimony of independent witnesses to the referendum vote counts in every part of Scotland. Russian independent witnesses, French independent witnesses, as well as Scottish independent witnesses, and many examples of blatant vote rigging, referendum fraud. It may well be that not only were the Secret Services heavily involved in the rigging of the referendum, but it may well be the case that some of them were acting as officers for the count in the referendum in order to make it very easy to fake the number of yeses and the number of noes. And in fact, it has been recorded on multiple media devices where it has become as plain as day that people were putting yes votes in the no count, and that thousands of people who registered to vote seemingly having cast their vote in the ballot. It is therefore apparent that either the so-called ruling establishment have become so desperate that they have made so many obvious basic schoolboy errors in the carrying out of this black operation in order that London keep hold of Scottish resources, and in particular, North Sea oil, and the gold that lies in them there hills. Or, this was a psyop from the very beginning, in order to capture the minds and hearts of the Scottish people, and just about every people on the face of the earth that yearns for independence from the tyrannical corporatist state. If that is the case, and with every fibre of my being, I pray that it is not, but in the event that it is, I will be forced to conclude by surveying all of the available information at this current time and ordering it in its logical sequence that civil war is the purpose of this operation. Civil war between nationalists of all kinds and those who wish to hang on to their slavery as an excuse for the EU commissars, the unelected, unaccountable bureaucrats of Brussels, the puppets of the puppet masters, the crown house of Rothschild, and the surviving Germanic royal bloodlines, to distance themselves from any possible allegations of culpability, and to bring down the jackboot of tyranny on the peoples of these islands. Otherwise, why are so many military vehicles and convoys being seen all over these lands? In Cornwall, in Yorkshire, in Cheshire, in Scotland. Why is it that a UN-style reconnaissance plane has been encircling the area that I live repeatedly and sporadically for the past 3 weeks? Why is it that driving with my daughter at 9:30 on a Sunday morning through a residential estate, I saw six paratroopers with machine guns in light combat gear. I wish the answer was not that somebody or some people within the establishment or the entire establishment is preparing to tyrannize the people of these lands and to bring about the devastation of the population that barely ekes out an existence, having been enslaved by the tyrannical House of Rothschild, which took control of every surviving royal dynasty between 1770 and 1815, when the Battle of Waterloo resulted in Nathan Rothschild, fawn on behalf of his father's house, taking control of 90% of world trade overnight. You tell me when the time came that that power, influence and control was lost. The House of Rothschild is one and the same as the House of Windsor, its bastard love child, that houses the remnants of the Germanic royal dynasties who long ago sold their souls in order to wipe out their debts and to join their resources and their illegitimate claims in order to create the monstrosity that has engulfed this entire planet. All out tyrannical aristocratic hegemony. A population enslaved by fraudulent debts. A population that has lost all sense of what is right and what is wrong. A population that yearns in its heart to be free. That men and women will rise up right across the face of the earth and say, no more. This has to end. There is no such thing as legitimate central government. It's a lie, yet another. The only way true freedom can ever arise is through the self-determination of the individual under natural law. My rights end only where yours begin. Do no harm, but take no shit. How much shit are you going to take? How much shit are you going to consume? How much is it going to take for you to realize that you are bequeathing a wasteland to your children? If you're lucky enough to have any. Common law grand juries. This is from Bouvier's. Grand jury. Practice. A body of men, or men and women, consisting of not less than 12 and not more than 24, although 25 has been known, respectively returned by the sheriff of every county to every session of the peace, over and termina and general jail delivery, and whom indictments are preferred. In other words, they prefer that it's a criminal matter and there's an indictment for a criminal complaint rather than a civil matter, but they have been used to determine civil matters as well, such as the banking matters. Two, there is just reason to believe that this institution existed among the Saxons, but it existed in the times of the ancient Britons from around at least 400 BC when the Mulmatine laws were brought into being. By the constitutions of Clarendon, it is provided that if such men were suspected, whom none wished or dared to accuse, the sheriff, being thereto required by the bishop, should swear 12 men of the neighbourhood or village to declare the truth, respecting such supposed crime. the jurors being summoned as witnesses or accusers rather than judges. If this institution did not exist before, it seems to be pretty certain that this statute established grand juries, or recognized them if they existed before, which is exactly what the case is. 3. A view of the important duties of grand juries will be taken by considering 1. The organization of the grand jury, 2. The extent of its jurisdiction, 3. The mode of doing business, 4. The evidence to be received, 5. The duty to make presentments, 6. The secrecy to be observed by the grand jury. It has to be done in private. Of the organization of the grand jury, the law requires that 24 citizens shall be summoned to attend on the grand jury, but in practice not more than 23 are sworn because of the inconvenience which might else arise of having 12, who are insufficient to find a true bill opposed to 12 others who might be against it. Upon being called, all who present themselves are sworn, as it scarcely ever happens that all who are summoned are in attendance. The grand jury cannot consist of less than 12, and from 15 to 20 are usually sworn. Being called into the jury box, they are usually permitted to select a foreman whom the court appoints, but the court may exercise the right to nominate one of them. The foreman then takes the following oath or affirmation, namely, you, the name, as foreman of this inquest for the body of the accused, do swear or affirm that you will diligently inquire and true presentments make of all such articles, matters, and things as shall be given in your charge or otherwise come to your knowledge touching the present service. The Commonwealth's counsel, your fellows, and your own, you shall keep secret. You shall present no one for envy, hatred, or malice, nor shall you leave anyone unrepresented for fear, favour, affection, hope of reward, or gain, but shall present all things truly as they come to your knowledge according to the best of your understanding, so help you God. It will be perceived that this oath contains the substance of the duties of the grand jury. The foreman having sworn or affirmed, the other grand jurors are sworn or affirmed according to this formula. You and each of you do swear or affirm that the same oath or affirmation which your foreman has taken on his part, you and every one of you shall well and truly observe on your part. End quote. Being so sworn or affirmed, and having received the charge of the court, the grand jury are organized and may proceed to the room provided for them to transact the business which may be laid before them. The grand jury constitutes a regular body until discharged by the court or by operation of law, if applicable, and where they cannot continue by virtue of an act of assembly beyond a certain day. But although they have been formally discharged by the court, if they have not separated, they may be called back and fresh bills submitted to them. 5. The extent of the grand jury's jurisdiction. Their jurisdiction is coextensive with that of the court for which they inquire, both as to the offences triable there and the territory over which such court has jurisdiction. In other words, a grand jury, by its very nature, can set the parameters of its jurisdiction, and it exists in coexistence with any other jurisdiction that coexists with it. But there doesn't have to be another jurisdiction that coexists with it. 6. The mode of doing business. The foreman acts as president, and the jury usually appoint one of their number to perform the duties of secretary. No records are to be kept of the acts of the grand jury except for their own use, because, as will be seen hereafter, their proceedings are to be secret. But thus prepared to enter upon their duties, the grand jury are supplied with bills of indictment by the Attorney General or other officer representing the state or commonwealth against offenders, but it can be representing the people as well. The witnesses are in attendance in another room and must be called when wanted. Before they are examined as to their knowledge of the matters mentioned in the indictment, care must be taken that they have been sworn or affirmed. For the sake of convenience, they are generally sworn or affirmed in open court before they are sent to be examined, and when so qualified, a mark to that effect is made opposite their names. 7. In order to save time, the best practice is to find a true bill or a true indictment as soon as the jury are satisfied that the defendant ought to be put upon his trial. It is a waste of time to examine any other witness after they have arrived at that conclusion. 12 at least must agree in order to find a true bill, but it is not required that they should be unanimous. Unless that number consent, the bill must be ignored. When a defendant is to be put upon his trial, the foreman must write on the back of the indictment a true bill, sign his name as foreman, and the date of the finding. On the contrary, where there is not sufficient evidence to authorize the finding of the bill, the jury return that they are ignorant whether the person accused committed the offense charged in the bill, which is expressed by the foreman endorsing on the bill, ignoramus, signing his name as before, and dating the time. 8. Of the evidence to be received, in order to ascertain the facts which the jury have not themselves witnessed, they must depend upon the statement of those who know them and who will testify to them. When the witness, from his position and ability, has been in a condition to know the facts about that which he testifies, he is deserving of implicit confidence. If, with such knowledge, he has no motive for telling a false or exaggerated story, has intelligence enough to tell what he knows and give a probable account of the transaction. If, on the other hand, from his position, he could not know the facts, or if knowing them, he distorts them, he is undeserving of credit. The jury are the able judges of the credit and confidence to which a witness is entitled. 9. Should any member of the jury be acquainted with any fact on which the grand jury ought to act, he must, before he testifies, be sworn or affirmed as any other witness, for the law requires this sanction in all cases. 10. As the jury are not competent to try the accused, but merely to investigate the case so far as to ascertain whether he ought to be put on his trial, they cannot hear evidence in his favour. Theirs is a mere preliminary inquiry. It is where he comes to be tried in court that he may defend himself by examining witnesses in his favour and showing the facts of the case. 11. Of presentments. The jury are required to make presentments of all such matters which may be given to them in charge, of which have otherwise come to their knowledge. A presentment, properly speaking, is the notice taken by the grand jury of any offence from their own knowledge, as of a nuisance, a libel, or the like. In these cases, the authors of the offence should be named so that they may be indicted. 12. Of the secrecy to be observed by the grand jury. The oath which they have taken obliges them to keep secret the Commonwealth's counsel, their fellows, and their own. Although contrary to the general spirit of our institutions, which do not shun daylight, this secrecy is required by law for wise purposes. It extends to the votes given in any case, to the evidence delivered by witnesses, and the communications of the jurors to each other. The disclosure of these facts, unless under the sanction of law, would render the imprudent juror who would make them public liable to punishment. Giving intelligence to a defendant that a bill has been found against him to enable him to escape is so obviously wrong that no one can for a moment doubt its being criminal. The grand juror who should be guilty of this offence might upon conviction be fined or imprisoned. The duration of the secrecy appears not to be definitely settled, but it seems this injunction is to remain as long as the particular circumstances of each case remain. In a case, for example, where a witness swears to a fact in open court on the trial, directly in opposition to what he swore before the grand jury, there can be no doubt the injunction of secrecy, as far as regards this evidence, would be at an end, and the grand juror might be sworn to testify what this witness swore in the grand jury's room, in order that the witness might be prosecuted for perjury. And all of that is from constitution.org, the Bouvier's Law Dictionary. Jurisdiction. Any government transaction against anyone in any respect, and you have the jurisdiction to convene a grand jury under common law. Any government breaking of articles of peace and security, every day, 24/7. Any dispute regarding anyone who has been diseased or removed by the government without a legal sentence of his peers from his lands, castles, liberties, or lawful right. Castles meaning homes. Dispute settlement. If the grand jury is informed of any dispute regarding anyone who has been removed by the government without a legal sentence of his peers from his lands, castles, liberties, or lawful right, then the dispute shall be settled by the grand jury. That's everybody who's ever been unlawfully evicted. Enforcement. 4 of the members must be shown that because of the government, a transgression has occurred against anyone in any respect, or b, or one of the articles of peace and security has been broken. Some or one of the articles of peace and security has been broken. The 4 members must show to the government the government's error. The 4 members, these are the 4 members, that by tradition, by common law tradition, 4 members of the grand jury present the true bill to the government. The 4 members must ask the government to amend that error without delay. If the government does not amend the error within 40 days after being shown the error, they're saying error instead of crime, then the four members shall refer the matter to the remainder of the grand jury. The grand jury may then distrain and oppress the government in every way in their power, namely by taking their homes, lands, possessions, and any way else they can until amends shall have been made according to the sole judgment of the grand jury. This is how tyrants have been removed down the ages. They made us think that we needed some kind of legislative sanction in order to continue using the common law grand jury. The common law grand jury is untouchable, and the common law is whatever the people say it is. Limitation of powers. The grand jury may not imprison or execute any government personnel or their children. Well, what if those government personnel are committing acts of genocide? I'm not saying they should be destroyed, but I am saying they should be stopped. And if that means that they have to be arrested, well, that means they got to be arrested, if that's the only way it's going to stop. They certainly arrest people with impunity, regardless of whether they've committed a real offense or not. Public support, critical aspect. Anyone, people or citizen, who chooses to help enforce the grand jury decision must first swear that he will obey the mandates of the grand jury, and that with them, to the extent of his power, he will impose the grand jury's decisions upon the government. The authority to support the grand jury is pre-authorized by the government. But if they refuse to authorize it, they're in breach of common law. So you proceed anyway. Limitations on government. The government is prohibited from doing anything to diminish the effect of the grand jury. If the government does prohibit or diminish the effectiveness of the grand jury, it shall be in vain and invalid and may not be used in any later proceeding by the government or anyone else. Termination of enforcement. When all issues are settled to the satisfaction of the grand jury, things shall return to normal as they were before, no grudges. But that doesn't mean that something else doesn't come to pass to replace the tyrannical nightmare that currently exists. It must. It absolutely must. Step one is to establish legitimacy among the people on these shores. To get public acceptance. Every dictator in history understood the power of the people and cultivated their support through enticements and threats. Reactivating the grand jury concept will go through four traditional stages: denial, ridicule, violent opposition, then self-evident acceptance. Theoretically, the grand jury can meet anywhere at any time, but that is hardly a good image. One way to get acceptance and minimize denial, ridicule, and violent opposition is to hold the grand jury sessions in the public courthouse or an old courthouse, because there's many of them about. The foreman could apply to a court administrator for use of one of the rooms in the public courthouse, as the councils do all the time for criminal council tax, etc. If it is refused, then the court administrator should, under common law procedures, be sued for his dereliction of duty. The grand jury should follow normal protocol. In other words, if the grand jury begins a process on its own, the resulting accusation is called a presentment. If a prosecutor originates a process, then the jury returns to the prosecutor an indictment, also called a true bill, on acceptance, or a no bill on denial. The second step to gain public acceptance is suggesting starting small. The grand jury could take on issues which anyone could easily see should be prosecuted. As public acceptance increases, the grand jury can enlarge its field of inquiry. The grand jury should have a strong public relations program for this step. This is essential. We need volunteers to spread this information. Obviously, it has to be distilled down in a form that pretty much anyone can understand. But the information, it still needs to go out there. And we need to drum up as much support in every community whenever we can. Step three, to take on larger projects. We may not have time to wait. We may have to go for the larger projects straight away. But we could say, well, it's an easier thing to prove certain allegations of genocide than it is other. You know, there are less people who disagree that innocent men, women and children are being slaughtered on foreign shores in the name of the British people by Her Majesty's government, or in the name of Her Majesty's government. Very few people would disagree that that is happening, whereas lots of people who haven't yet come across the information would disagree that chemtrailing is going on, for instance. How a common law grand jury is constituted. Grand jury members must be elected from the people, not citizens. So it can't be done as a straw man, as a citizen subject slave. It has to be done as one of the people. There are no rules defining a procedure about how the grand jury is elected, though. The people, without the influence of government, decide for themselves how the grand jury members are to be elected, and there must be 25 members, according to Bill Thornton, despite the definitions in Bouvier's saying differently. The members must be people of the jurisdiction and not citizens of the jurisdiction. For example, they must be the people of the United States, or people of California, or people of the state of California, not the citizenry of the United States, or a citizen of California, nor the citizen of the state of California. When the grand jury meets, if any are absent after being summoned, then those who are present constitute a quorum, provided there are at least 12. All decisions of a grand jury are decided by the majority vote of the members present. If any member dies or leaves the country, or in any way is prevented from carrying out the grand jury's decisions, the remaining grand jurors shall choose another to fill his place, and he shall likewise be sworn in. Okay, so this is from Hansard's.
1837. Mr. Prime rose to move for leave to bring in a bill to abolish grand juries in England. He was aware that the subject, though one of great and general importance, was not a very entertaining one. At times, however, it became necessary to inquire whether certain institutions had not outlived their usefulness. Again, sound familiar? And did not any longer answer the end for which they were instituted. At one time, the grand jury system was justly considered as one of the great bulwarks of English liberty. But now grand jurors were no more than an appeal from the committing magistrate. According to Lord Somers, who was a high authority upon the point, grand juries were instituted to search out crime, to find out offences, and not, as now merely, to put cases in a train for trial. In his opinion, the grand jury system was, in many cases, an obstruction to justice. In Scotland, there were no grand juries, but there was a public prosecutor, and when a judgment was given against anyone, it was submitted to the Lord Advocate or the Sheriff. He was not about to propose the adoption of any such principle in this country, although it would be competent for him to do so if he thought it would do good. The Honourable Member proceeded to quote a variety of evidence as to the inefficiency of grand juries. The House divided, ayes 25, noes 196. So, in that vote, 196 voted against the abolition of grand juries with a majority of 171. The grand juries, I should like to make quite clear to my honorary friends on the side of the House, gives to every prisoner another chance. Some honorary members may say the grand jury is constituted entirely of the more prosperous people in the country. That may be conceivably an argument for democratising the grand jury, but it is no argument for abolishing grand juries. Cases were cited to us in committee, and they are known to this House, where real injustice has been avoided by the opportunity in grand jury of throwing out a bill when a man ought not to have been committed for trial at all. A power to correct a mistake made before the justices. What is the argument for the abolition of the grand jury? The grand jury is one of the most ancient and certainly the most integral parts of our system of criminal justice, which has always assumed the grand jury as the only channel through which the law brought a prisoner to trial before a petty jury. And I submit that it is a very serious thing, lightly, to alter this old machinery of criminal justice. It is said that people who are now summoned on grand juries would be saved a certain amount of trouble and possibly expense if they were not so summoned. That is a very fallacious argument. It's of no value. One of the strongest arguments in favour of the retention of the grand jury is that it does attempt to make people in various counties and boroughs interested in the administration of justice. It is a great mistake to think that justice should be a matter entirely concerning professional people, or white-collar criminals, as I prefer to call them. The whole idea of the grand jury is that people in the counties and in the boroughs should take a personal interest in its administration of justice in their districts. As I see it, the tendency is for the administration of criminal justice to become more and more professionalised, more and more a matter of bureaucracy and expert regulation. Again, we know what's going on. Against that, the grand jury is and always has been a very, very good corrective. It may well be that in the future, the times may be more troublous than they are now. Indeed. There is no doubt, particularly in times of very keen political feeling, that grand juries have done a great service in the past to cure injustice, notably at the beginning of the last century. There was a case after case where men were saved the need of standing their trial before a petty jury through the action of the grand jury, particularly in the City of London, in refusing to return true bills. Are people not as much entitled to a proper consideration of their case now as they were 100 years ago? What are the circumstances which have arisen during the last 100 years which have made grand juries less necessary than they were a century ago? This proposal arises simply from the radical itch for change which possesses the Right Honourable Gentleman and his colleagues. He thinks he must do something to alter criminal justice administration in this country. He says, let us destroy something, let us destroy the grand jury first. We have been told that these Bolsheviks, if I'm not using a defamatory term, have succeeded in destroying the grand jury at quarter sessions. They will go on very shortly to destroy the grand jury at Assizes. Criminal Justice Act 1925-19, power to dispense with grand jury at quarter sessions, where this is utterly fake if you think about it, where all persons committed have pleaded guilty. If by the fifth day preceding the day appointed for holding any quarter sessions, no persons have been committed for trial at the sessions except persons in respect of whom a certificate has been transmitted in pursuance of Section 4 of the Administration of Justice Act 1920, stating that they have pleaded guilty or admitted the truth of the charge, there shall be deemed to be no business requiring the attendance of grand jurors at the sessions, and that the provisions of the Assizes and Quarter Sessions Act 1908 shall apply accordingly.
On the first page of the Administration of Justice Miscellaneous Provisions Act 1933, it states, an act to abolish grand juries and amend the law as to the presentment of indictments, to provide for the summary determination of questions as to liability for death duties, to make provision for alternative procedure for the recovery of Crown debts, and to enable proceedings by the Crown to be instituted in county courts in appropriate cases, to amend the procedure as to certain prerogative writs and as to trials by jury in the High Court, to amend the law as to the payment of costs by and to the Crown, to provide for the further delegation of the jurisdiction of the Master in Lunacy, and for purposes connected with the matters aforesaid. This purported Act of Parliament is void ab initio on its face, for the simple reason, in the history of the grand jury or any such public forum for righting the wrongdoings of any individual, whether they represent any form of government or their own private vested interests, no government can ever be said to have the jurisdiction to abolish or to even interfere with the grand jury process under common law. In other words, the Act of Parliament was a nullity from the outset, and a declaration of the people to that effect is all that is necessary to annul the statute, because it is an aberration of common law. We'll be right back.